what I'd like to do with this section is to ask the people who teach in law school what they think, if anything, they've learned. That is, we're all operating in a world in which the free market mindset is dominant, and we've been talking about it today. And I'm just, what I want to try to do is get a sense of whether we've learned whether you've learned anything, whether you knew this anyway, but just had a different name for it, whether you actually disagree with aspects of what, say, social psychologists or historians have had to tell us, or economists of a particular stripe. So I'm just going to continue the conversation now by my being quiet and seeing if anyone wants to say anything out of this group here so far. Jim?
I haven't been thinking about pressing the button on the microphone. but I've been, it's been a fascinating brainstorm of information for the past 7 or 8 hours, and I'm still processing a lot of it, and I think I'll continue to do that, and I think that's sort of the defining characteristic of a worthwhile conference, is that your neurons are firing. So they're still firing, and maybe not in a thoroughly coherent fashion. So with that disclaimer, so there's a lot of information about the way the market mindset dominates how we approach collectively as a society so many issues, from choice to the nature of mortgage lending and the nature of the financial crisis, et cetera. Some of the things that I'm thinking about are how the market mindset constrains us and prevents us from thinking in other ways. So I just think in the field in which I work, which is human rights, a couple of things that the enormous force of the market mindset does in terms of human rights. One of the things that I think it does is that it drives many people who seek to work or think about social emancipation towards human rights, in part because human rights is primarily a framework that implicitly accepts the market mindset and mostly steers clear of issues that directly challenge the market mindset. And another way in which that happens, I see, is within the human rights field. Once people are in the human rights field, they're thinking within the framework of individual rights, is we tend to steer away from questions of distributional justice and injustice. So we take a pass on the whole, generally, most of us in human rights, the economic meltdown that we're seeing, because it's hard for us to frame it in individual rights in ways that are legitimate within the increasingly, not necessarily increasingly, but very constrained way that economic rights approach the idea of distributional injustice, that they'll seek some sort of violator, some clear violation, et cetera. And so just, I want to toss it into the mix, are ways, thinking about ways in which, in addition to all the things that we've thought about the market mindset, how we don't think about things, how we shy away from things, how we think things are not appropriate for our sub-disciplines because of the dominance of the market mindset. So I think, and the question would be, how much is that applicable to other sub-disciplines of the law or other areas or other perspectives or approaches?
I just want to modify. So you said we don't think of those things because of the dominance of the market mindset, but it might also be the reverse, which is the market mindset is dominant because we don't want to think about those things. Yes.
So I wanted to say, like you, I'm still processing all of this, and it was enormously generative, and thanks to John and to all the students and the presenters, and wonderful to see so many of our good students here and listening and participating. So maybe human beings need categories to process things, and we all bring our own categories. So the work that I do is on taxation and social welfare policy, and I tend to bring a lens of sort of political theory. And so I'm hearing political theory in the room today, right? So critiques of welfare economics, quite explicit in Doug's wonderful presentation. And in the fields I work in, particularly, well, in both taxation and in social welfare policy, so the conventions of the branch of economics known as public finance have been heavily influential in law schools. And so, for example, while it's certainly true to say that in public finance or in public economics, one can admit discussions of market failure, it's also, I think, the convention and the presumption that markets are welfare maximizing unless you can show a market failure, right? That there's a kind of presumption that markets are welfare maximizing institutions unless the challenger can come forward and delineate two things. One, that there is a market failure, and two, that the available and practical remedies for it are not worse than the original problem, right? So that there's a kind of burden of proof there. We've also heard today what I would call, although this hasn't been so much in today's vocabulary, criticisms of libertarianism, right? Robert Nozick's version of libertarianism in particular, sort of the idea that markets are just and that patterned views of equality or outcomes are unjust. And indeed, you know, sometimes what I, the kinds of things that I have proposed, and here I love John's reactant stuff, because so I write about what I would call just distribution, but what is often termed conventionally redistribution. And can you hear the reactants in that? You want to redistribute, right, from the implicitly fair baseline of my stuff, you want to take it away and thus degrade the family, right, by imposing an estate tax, or degrade the efforts of good people to accumulate wealth by taxing it, or degrade families by making it possible for parents not to engage in paid employment, right? These are challenges to the kind of stuff that I've proposed. Finally, I think we've heard, you know, feminist perspectives glaringly, of course, horribly, in John's survey of American advertising, women being chopped up, women being identified with, you know, the greatest evil that we can imagine. I mean, women, incredible. But we've also heard strands of, so that's just misogyny, right? It's out there, it's being used for cynical gain. The feminists have known this, right? For a long time, but it's still there. But also, you know, feminist critiques of the market as rendering care work invisible, right? Care work doesn't go into the GDP. It's not rendered visible in the way that we talk about markets. And that family work, the work of family, care for others, it came out in some of the presentations. I'm looking at Nicole in the back row and her presentation, you know, in the self-awareness actually of the working class college students of saying, I'm connected to those people that helped send me here and I have opportunities that they don't. And I actually thought that was very poignant as a explicit recognition of family ties, which sometimes, you know, again, one of John's dichotomies in his first thing was, you know, family versus market, public versus private, and so on. And so I'm old enough to remember the, you know, sort of time when this would have been, you know, primarily feminism, but it's wonderful to see the flowering of alternative perspectives. And finally, for me, just, you know, you can not only translate, for me, some of the insights of this conference into political theory, but also some of the lessons that I have learned from liberal, not libertarian, but liberal egalitarian political theory, lessons like there's not just one thing called the market. Right? Background institutions matter. The market is not self-justifying. There are many iterations of the market. Markets are a human institution. They're good for some things and not good for other things. And you have to have a deeper vocabulary about value and about justice to say what it is they are good for, when, under what circumstances, and for whom. And I think that's been in the room today, too.